Thank you, Your Honor. I would like to reserve a bit of my time, maybe we'll say 7 minutes for the rebuttal on this case. In this case, we're only talking about the summary judgment issues. It was timely filed. And in this case, appellant would maintain that there were reasonable facts in dispute on both sides, and it's shown in the record that there's a very different understanding of what happened to Mr. Reif in this case.
So what's the protected activity in Mr. Reif's case?
Sure. The initial protected activity in Mr. Reif's case was he was complaining about being required to transport what he was of the understanding were hazardous chemicals based on what his previous supervisor had told him. It was his understanding that under the law, you were required to have specific licenses and there were specific requirements for transporting these hazardous chemicals, yet he was required to do it to, meet certain sales goals, essentially.
Okay. So these were detergents, correct?
I believe so, yes, Your
Honor. And as it ends up, you do not need a particular certification or license to transport these detergents, correct? So we don't have a statute in play, right?
I would agree with that, but that was not my client's understanding at the time, and I would.
And his understanding was based on what somebody had told him at a previous place of employment, correct?
I believe it's the same place of employment, Your Honor, but a previous supervisor. Either way, his previous supervisor had made it clear to him, and he trusted that.
I'm having trouble finding.
Yeah, I have the same question that Judge Christensen was raising. Is it contrary to law to transport these products without a special license, or is it not?
Your Honor, I do not believe that there is law that supports that it is contrary to law. However, I do believe that Mr. Reif had a reasonable belief that it was a violation of law and that he was complaining about that reasonable belief and that that is what resulted in him being retaliated against and terminated.
What is your best case that says a protected activity can just be based on a reasonable belief?
Sure.
When there isn't a law underlying it.
The best case would be the same case that I cited in response to the previous argument, which would be the Weingard versus Harland Financial Services Solutions, Inc. I'm sorry, I tripped over that, so I'm going to say it one more time. Weingard versus Harland Financial Solutions, Inc.
What does that case
which
say?
Is,
why does it support you?
I believe it supports us, Your Honor, because it says that the protections under the whistleblower statute, under 1102.5C specifically, they can be extended to include the employee's reasonable belief of an unlawful activity. And I believe
anytime an employee thinks something might be wrongful in their belief, I guess reasonable, we look at it in the light most favorable plaintiff, then that's going to survive summary judgment.
I don't know that it's that cut and dry, Your Honor, but with respect to the reasonableness, I do believe that there are facts in dispute here as to whether Mr. Reif reasonably believed this to be a violation of law. I could see a case where, for example, let's say in this case, Mr. Reif had raised the issues and Shamrock had said, no, no way, no how. You don't need to have this special license. Look, here's the material data safety sheet or something saying you don't need this. Then I would agree it would be really difficult to come to the, almost impossible to come to the conclusion that Mr. Reif was reasonable in his belief that this was unlawful activity. However, in this case, we don't have a statute on point saying that this is unlawful. However, we have Mr. Reif putting forth that his prior supervisor informed him that these were required and it was a legal requirement for the safety of the public and the driver.
So let's just sort of step back here. So your argument is that because he had heard from a previous employee or somebody within the organization that he shouldn't be transporting detergents without a certification or a license, that he complained to Shamrock regarding that, and then they put him on a performance improvement plan, and that was pretextual to wanting to terminate him because he had commented about transporting detergents based on something that had been said to him by somebody else. I mean, that's the case, isn't it?
That is basically it, Your Honor. I mean,
that's your retaliation claim. You've got other claims.
Yes. There are other claims. There's a small addition to the retaliation claim that I'd like to briefly add, but that he was also complaining about what he believed to be unlawful deductions from his paycheck.
Right, but that, yeah, okay. Yeah, I understand that. Okay. What was the complaint that was made to Shamrock about, I'm trying to remember, I get confused between this case and Strickland, regarding the medical condition that he had, or was it relating to a child or a family member?
This was related to his child.
Okay. And was that complaint or that request made, or was that knowledge imparted to Shamrock before or after Shamrock had determined to terminate him?
Your Honor, it is our position that it was made before. There are facts in dispute. There's a declaration. Let me back up one second. The only evidence that the defendants have presented in support of their assertion now that the decision was made to terminate him before he made that request is a self-serving declaration of the HR representative. There is no documentary evidence. There are no emails between anyone at Shamrock evidencing that this decision was made to terminate him until he calls them on the morning of February 26th, tells them of his daughter's debilitating diagnosis and that he will need some time to care for her, and later that day the paperwork is drawn up to terminate him. Therefore, plaintiffs maintain that the decision was that day, appellant, I apologize. However, there certainly were facts in dispute as to that issue that could go to a trier of fact to determine when that day actually was, rather than them being summarily adjudicated.
I had a question. Is there any documentary evidence to support the fact? No, I'm sorry, this was on the pay stubs. Did Mr. Reif produce his pay stubs on summary judgment?
Your Honor, I believe that they did produce the ones that were available. Let me find them for you. I apologize.
Can you show me in the record where that occurred?
Yes, let me find them for you. I apologize. This one has fairly significant excerpts of the record. I believe his, his pay stubs appear on Exhibit C to the excerpts of the record beginning at 099.
Exhibit C, ER?
Yes.
Number 99?
Yes, and this is the pay stub that's included is what I believe to be his final pay stub, indicating that he was not paid for the vacation hours that he's asserting.
I thought the only evidence you had was his testimony of looking at pay stubs. I didn't think he produced any, but I'll look at this. Thank you.
Yes.
You're at your 6 minutes
yes, thank
and
you.
13 seconds. So.
Thank you.
May it please the court, Andrew Summer, counsel for Shamrock Foods Company. This is a fairly straightforward case of wrongful termination. The appellant, Mr. Reif, had the opportunity to conduct significant discovery in this case, both by deposing the key decision maker, Chris Jenkins, who was involved in the termination decision, as well as the HR representative, Monica Hergert. Despite the discovery that's been conducted in this case, the plaintiff has relied largely on his own self-serving declaration to support his claims. He has not offered any admissible evidence that would undermine the termination decision, both as to the timing and the motivation for the decision. The termination decision was made on February 25th, and we have provided testimony, a sworn statement from Chris Jenkins that supports the timing of that decision.
Is there any other documentary evidence to support that decision or reflects that decision being made on the 25th?
Correct. There is, in the declaration of Chris Jenkins, he does identify as part of the timeline that he received a sales report by email on February 25th in the morning, and that's what prompted him, based on his review of the full sales performance from the 1st to the 24th of that month, that Mr. Reif was not going to make his sales goals. And based on that information, they put in motion, they knew that they were going to meet with him on March 1st one way or the other, based on the performance improvement plan. They made the decision, or Chris Jenkins made the decision in consultation with management to then proceed with the termination. And Mr. Jenkins continued to monitor Mr. Reif's performance through the first to ensure that he was correct and that he was not going to meet those goals. And then a point I wanted to make is that Mr. Reif insists that the termination decision was suspect, and that's based on his own self-serving, subjective conclusion. And despite having the opportunity to cross-examine defense witnesses in this case, he hasn't offered any testimony that would suggest that, in fact, the decision was not made on the 25th, nor has he offered any other documentary evidence.
I just asked about pay stubs. I know that's a different allegation there, but is that, if I look at Exhibit CER number 99, is that going to be the pay stubs?
Right. That is the final pay stub for Mr. Reif, and that shows the payout on the floating holiday. Mr. Reif what it appears that Mr. Reif is claiming is that he had one more floating holiday, but he has not provided any evidence indicating how it is that he had this additional floating holiday. We provided the declaration of Monica Herger. Ms. Herger was deposed in this case, and she has testified that she has reviewed the payroll system and confirmed that floating holiday was not deducted. And specifically, that's the floating holiday where Mr. Reif claims that he worked on January 1st and that the employees across the board were being deducted floating holidays for that day because they presumably weren't working. He sent an email to Thax Turner in management indicating that he had worked on the 1st in response to Thax Turner's email. And Mr. Turner responded back indicating you will not be, don't deduct essentially for this floating holiday, copying payroll, and that was an email to Mr. Reif. There is no evidence in this case that in fact that floating holiday, contrary to that email by Thax Turner, was deducted. Now, in terms of the decision in this case, you know, there are wrongful termination cases where there's subjective reasons for termination. It can be how an employee interacts with customers, with coworkers, things of that nature. Here, this termination was based on objective criteria. It was based on sales goals. They had measurable, specific sales goals that were identified for Mr. Reif that he admits he did not achieve. And he does not claim that other sales reps were not subject to these types of goals.
When was his performance improvement plan put in place?
It was put in place on January 30th, 2013.
And when was he terminated?
He was terminated on March 1st.
So they gave him 2 months. Well, they gave him 1 month.
Correct.
To perform, and then he was gone.
Right, but this was the culmination of a period of counseling beginning at least in October of 2012. So they had met, and this is all in the record, the plaintiff had met with his managers to discuss his performance and that he wasn't making the mark in achieving these goals. They then, not until a number of months later on, did they actually put him on the performance improvement plan. And then at that point, they even reduced his sales goals in half to a very low threshold to essentially give him every opportunity to succeed. And then he didn't make that mark, and on that basis, they terminated him. And so this wasn't a rash decision. You know, Shamrock only terminated after giving him this opportunity at counseling to improve his performance and then providing him that 30 days for the performance improvement plan. In terms of the FMLA and CFRA claims, there needs to be evidence that the termination or that that the qualifying leave was a negative factor in the termination. Simply here, Mr. Reif hasn't provided any such evidence.
I want to go back to Judge Murguia's question. She asked if there was any objective evidence supporting the date when Shamrock determined that they were going to terminate Mr. Reif. And you said, well, we've got a declaration of the person that made the decision to terminate. Mr. Jenkins, was it Mr. Jenkins?
I think it was
correct.
Mr. Jenkins.
All right, Mr. Jenkins. So are you saying that the evidence of this, and it appeared to me from my review of the record, the evidence of this, what we have here is that Mr. Jenkins decided in his mind that he was going to terminate him on this particular day, I think it was in January. And then is it the next day that Mr. Reif advises Mr. Jenkins of this circumstance with his child?
That's what Mr. Reif alleges, that on the 26th of the month.
So the only evidence that we have, back to Judge Murguia's question, the only evidence that we have in terms of Shamrock's decision to terminate is the declaration of Mr. Jenkins that he'd made this decision in his mind.
Right.
It's not documented. He doesn't send an email, doesn't make a note to the memo to the personnel file, anything like that.
From Mr. Jenkins himself, there is no specific document. What we
right.
do have is the email he received with the sales targets, whether Mr. Reif was making them. Then we have him in consultation with management making the decision to terminate on the 25th as indicated in a sworn declaration. Then we have a declaration from Monica Hergert indicating that the next day on the 26th, she completed the termination report. We provide that termination report. That's an exhibit to her declaration. Then we have testimony that a meeting was scheduled with Mr. Reif and that he came in the office on the 1st for the termination meeting. And so what's key here is, you know, especially given California law and the obligation to provide the final paycheck on termination, and that they wanted to meet with him in person, they had to put the wheels in motion several days before the actual termination, both in terms of making the decision, completing the termination report, requesting the final paycheck, calling him into the office, and then having the meeting. And you know, the opposing counsel could have deposed all of management that was involved in the termination discussions. They could have provided testimony attempted to try to undermine that decision. They haven't provided any testimony from Chris Jenkins, Monica Herger, or anyone else in management that would somehow impact this issue and create a genuine issue of material fact. I did want to address a couple issues around the Section 1102.5C claim. The case that was cited by Mr. Reif's counsel, the Weingard, actually states a different proposition. It's consistent with all other authority on this point that you actually, under subsection C, you need to establish a legal violation. You can't state that there was a good faith belief that you were violating the law and therefore state a claim for protected activity. And here, there was no testimony by Mr. Reif that he refused, as for the cleaning products, that he refused to even transport them, let alone that in doing so, that would be a legal violation. And just to clarify a minor point, that he claims that it was an employee at his former employer business that told him that a hazmat certification was required to transport certain products. It wasn't at Shamrock.
Yeah, that's what I thought as well from the record.
And in terms of, there's a question about whether, I mean, there, or the undisputed facts show that there was no protected activity on the two parts of the 1102.5 claim. And even if he could meet that threshold, assuming arguendo, there is no causal link or evidence of a pretext. He has not provided anything outside of proximity in time to support that claim.
So you're saying in order to establish protected activity in this case, he would have had to have refused to transport these chemicals under the Weingard case?
Correct. And there's mostly decisions from the district court level, but all the cases have supported the notion that there needs to be a refusal. And those words are clearly delineated in the statutory provision. So it's really two parts. You have to communicate a refusal, and you have to, that refusal has to concern essentially a request that you participate in activity that would be unlawful. And so the Chen decision, for example, makes clear that mere sequence is not enough to establish causation. There's a line of other cases that we've cited in our answering brief that reach the same conclusion. And here, you know, we simply don't have any evidence that would support any such causal connection. And then as for the Section 2802 claim, the Gattuso case by the California Supreme Court is very clear that an employer may have a travel allowance that's provided to compensate for automobile-related expenses for work purposes. And we have provided testimony that this allowance was determined based on the expected out-of-pocket costs by the account executives. And Mr. Reif did receive written discovery asking for information documents to support his actual out-of-pocket expenses to determine whether, in fact, he could be owed more than was paid by the travel allowance. He clearly responded that he had no information or documents.
Did he have insurance?
He did. That's my understanding from his testimony.
Was he required to have insurance as part of his employment and use of his own vehicle by Shamrock, required by Shamrock?
He was, and there's no authority that would prevent an employer from requiring that as a condition for driving a vehicle for work-related purposes. Okay. He referenced a repair estimate he received, but the district judge ruled that statement was inadmissible because based on the best evidence rule. So it wasn't before the district court. Even if it were admissible, he's talking about, I believe, a couple $1,000. Mr. Reif was receiving $1,250 a month. So by any reasonable measure, he would have been compensated for that type of loss, assuming that's all of his loss. And then, lastly, as to the floating holiday question, Mr. Reif just hasn't referenced any document or anything that would show, in fact, he was deducted for that floating holiday, contrary to what was represented to him by Thax Turner in that email and in his conversation. And so based on the fact that the floating holiday was not deducted and there's no evidence to support that, then all of the Section 224, 201, and 226 claims that are attendant to that allegation would be appropriate for summary judgment. Mr. Reif's appeal is based on his own conjecture and speculation, and he has offered no admissible evidence central to his claims, raising a tribal issue. Accordingly, we request that the panel affirm summary judgment in this case. Thank you.
Thank you. Nels?
Good morning for the last time today. Thank you. First, I would like to point out the issues that were just being discussed with respect to the deduction of the vacation hours from Mr. Reif's paycheck. There is Mr. Reif's declaration from paragraphs 10 through 12, which begins on 032ER and goes to 033, spell out that he looked at his pay stubs prior to January 1st, so in December of 2012, and saw that he had a certain amount of hours. And then they were deducted after the 1st. He did send the email counsel addressed asking that those be recredited back because he worked on the 1st. And those were not recredited. And those, yes, there's the documents have to be explained. It's difficult to see from the pay stub itself whether or not he got hours because we don't have the extrinsic evidence of how many he should have gotten. But with his declaration, it's explaining how many hours plaintiff maintained he should have gotten versus what you can see in the record of that pay stub of what he actually did acquire. excuse me. With respect,
I can hear about 8 or 9 hours.
I believe we are, Your Honor.
That he contends he was not paid.
Yes, Your Honor. Yes.
Okay.
Second, I would like to briefly correct my statements previously that it was his supervisor at the current employer. The court and opposing counsel are correct that Mr. Reif's declarations say that his belief of the unlawful activity was based on something he had gleaned from a prior employer. So I apologize for that misstatement and wanted to correct it. Finally, I would like to address the issue of the timing of when this happened, not only with respect to Mr. Reif informing his company of his young daughter, not young, sorry, his daughter's multiple sclerosis diagnosis and his need to help her, but in addition, it was before the end of this performance improvement plan. His supervisors pulled the sales report, as is said by both sides, they pulled it through the 24th of February. However, he was supposed to be judged through the 1st of March. In many sales positions, there's a lot that happens at the end of the month that people rush to get things done. And it's our position that that's an additional piece of evidence in support of the pretextual nature of this termination, that regardless of what Mr. Reif did to satisfy this PIP, and had he been able, had he had the time, maybe he could have satisfied the TIP, or the PIP, I apologize. But this was determined at an early phase before all of the evidence was in, whether he met the goals or didn't meet the goals.
So why do you think he was terminated? What's the pretext here? Is it the complaining about transporting detergents, or is it making a claim under the Family Medical Leave Act and the California counterpart, or both?
Your Honor, we would maintain that it was both, that within shortly before he was put on the PIP, Mr. Reif made the complaints about the various issues that have been talked about today. And then the day that his termination paper was drawn up, which was still a couple of days before his actual termination and the end of his performance improvement plan, that morning he informed his company of his daughter's diagnosis and his need to take FMLA and CFRA leave to care for her.
Was he performing in a court? I mean, I realize your argument that he still had a few days left on the first month of his performance improvement plan, but up to the point of his termination, had he met the goals of the performance improvement plan?
Your Honor, I believe that it's a difficult answer to say. We would maintain that he was on track to meet those goals. The goals of the performance improvement plan laid out something that he needed to do within the time period. And so without giving him the full time period, but judging him by the full goals, it's pretextual.
Sure, evidence that he was on track to meet that.
Sure. I believe there's a... give me one second. I believe it would be in the sealed portion of the record that I believe Mr. Reif, and I apologize, I don't have the site for you here, had a spreadsheet indicating which where his sales were and which ones he in expected to close timely. And they were, as well as the contacts that he was meeting with and all that type of stuff that was required under the PIP. I believe that's in the sealed excerpt, which is much shorter. And I apologize, I can't get it to open right this second to get to the site, but that's where I believe the evidence is.
Well, I had a chance, and I'm looking, what you pointed me to regarding the final pay stub, but it's not really clear what Mr. Reif accrued before the payout, and I'm not sure there's anything here to support, you know, the evidence that his claims on California Code 201, 224, and 226 are successful. Is that your best evidence that you can cite to for that?
Your Honor, that is the best document itself, but I believe that it needs to be read in connection with Mr. Reif's declaration explaining where the hours are.
Okay. Does anybody else have any other questions?
No questions here.
Thank you very much for your time.
All right,
thank you, Ms. Knowles and Mr. Summer, and then Ms. Marcial. Appreciate your presence and your arguments here today. The case of Paul Reif versus Shamrock Foods is now submitted.